Let's see now the physiology of your information. And before we start, I need you to think of your information as a simply line. What does this mean? It means at different places along the nephron, there are different processes happening. And in general, these processes, we can describe them in three steps or as three processes. The first one, there is the filtration. And the filtration is happening at the glomerulus here. Then there is reabsorption and secretion. And these two processes are happening at the VCT, at the nephron lobe, and at the DCT. Remember, we said reabsorption is taking out of urine, whereas secretion is putting into urine. So let's start with the first process, the filtration at the glomerulus, or the glomerular filtration. Now, we said, if you remember when we talked about the glomerulus, we said there is this blood supply would come inside with the capsule and there will be filtration there. Now, there are three different driving forces for the filtration to happen. And in general, that filtration, we can think of it as a net movement of the fluid through the glomerulus. So what are these three forces? First one, there is the blood hydrostatic pressure. And the blood hydrostatic pressure is the blood pressure. The blood pressure within the glomerulus. Now, if you remember, we said the blood comes through the afferent arterioli and exits through the efferent arterioli. And we said the afferent is larger than the efferent. So there is always more blood coming, less blood exiting. This means that inside these capillaries, inside the glomerulus, we will have higher blood pressure. This high blood pressure would force the fluid out of these blood capillaries through the filtration membrane, mainly water. We are forcing water outside these filtration membrane. And water is carrying these solvents. Remember, anything that is smaller than 8 nanometer would exit through these pores or through the sleds or through the filtration membrane. So this is the first and the major driving force toward forming urine. Next one, there is the blood colloid osmotic pressure. What does it mean? Now, if you remember osmotic pressure, when we talk about osmosis, if you remember, osmosis is water movement from area of high solute concentration to area of low solute concentration. So here, I want you to think of what's happening. We said the water is being forced out, and this water is carrying these different solutes. So this will generate an area of high concentration of this solvent, where in the Bowman's capsule, in this space between the Bowman's capsule and the glomerulus, in this space. So this space, all of this white space, will be filled with water or a filtrate, technically it's a filtrate, that is filled with high concentration of solutes. Whereas in the blood, we will have the area of low solute concentration. This means that here, this is an area of high solute concentration, which suggests, based on osmosis, that there is an opposite movement of water backward toward the glomerulus. So this is an opposing movement to the filtrate. The third force is the capsular hydrostatic pressure. And the capsular hydrostatic pressure is the pressure that is generated because of the presence of water or the filtrate in this narrow space. This is a very narrow space and we are putting a lot of water there. So this will generate also an opposing force. This opposing force will drive the filtrate back to the glomerulus along with the colloid osmotic pressure. However, as long as the blood hydrostatic pressure is higher than both the colloid and the hydrostatic pressure, we will have a positive net outward pressure, which means that there is continuous formation of urine based on the net of these values. And that is something known as the net filtration process. Now, this net filtration process would affect the glomerular filtration rate, and this is a number that would measure the quality of blood filtration by the kidneys. The other thing is we need to understand that all of this is a passive process. We are not spending any ATP during filtration. No ATP has been used during filtration, only a passive force. Now, after we have the filtrate will go through the proximal convoluted tubule to the nephron loop, down and up, and then to the distal convoluted tubule. And here, there are various processes happening, mainly secretion and reabsorption. Secretion and reabsorption. So for example, at the proximal convoluted tubule, we said earlier that we have good reabsorption of water, bicarbonate, chloride, magnesium, calcium, potassium, sodium, plus anything that might escape the urine, like glucose, amino acid, protein, vitamins, all of these should be drawn back or reabsorbed back. And most of these processes are active transportation because we are using energy. We are transporting them from areas of high concentration, that's the filtrate, to an area of low concentration. Then it will go through the descending part of the nephron loop, where is mainly water is being reabsorbed, and then the ascending, where are the ions are reabsorbed, taking them then to the distal convoluted tubule, where we have some reabsorption of ions, some secretions of other ions, and into the collecting duct, which mainly about reabsorbing water. Now, we said here it's ATP, sometimes even here it's ATP, sometimes even here it's ATP, but also sometimes it's passive. So not necessarily all of these being transported through active transport mechanisms. And the other thing we said, that mainly in the distal convoluted tubule and in the collecting duct, this is under the influence of the hormones. So this would respond to a systemic changes through the entire body. Whereas these in the nephron loop and the BCT, it's responding to the local environment, to the concentration based on the local environment. So I will stop here. In the following video, we will talk about urine and we will talk about generating concentrated or diluted urine.